touch of your lips, dear, but much more for the touch of your whips, dear. You can raise welts like nobody else as we dance to the masochism tango. Say our love is a flame, not an ember. Say it's me that you want.
Hi everybody, and welcome to this week's episode of the A-Slut podcast, that of course stands for advice, sex, love, understanding, and trust. We talk about all things sexual, relationship-wise, polyamorous, alternative lifestyles, swinging, kink, all sorts of that fun stuff. And if you ever want to get in touch with the show, you can do so by DMing into the Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, all at the A-Slut Podcast. You're always welcome to do that. You can always email the show at theaslutpodcast@gmail.com. I always love hearing from you guys, so let's get into it.
My soul is on fire, it's aflame with desire, which is why I perspire when we tango. You caught my nose in your left castanet, love. I can feel the pain yet, love.
So I have another guest this week, people. And I'm really, really excited to have spoken to them. It was a really, really cool discussion with somebody that I've only really just met in the Twitterverse, in the Twitter world. They're really, truly amazing cat star. She's really quite knowledgeable about a number of things, and she is an author. Her audio book of her book has just come out. She is the author of Yelling in Pasties, The Wet Coast Confessions of an Anxious Slut. It is really, really cool. I've started listening to it now on Audible. I'll put all the links and all of that sort of stuff in the description. But we talked to her today again about the online relationships. We're continuing on this theme. There's probably going to be one more episode about this, I think, and then we'll give it a rest and talk about something different. But really, really cool chat with Kat and how her online relationships worked and how each of them differed and things like that, and why it appealed to her to get into these sort of, I guess, for lack of a better term, situations. Really, really cool, really, really neat, and really, really fun as well. What's happening in my world? Well, guess what, sluts? At this point, maybe, it's not completely confirmed yet, but it's very, very close. I may be going on tour and taking the podcast with me. I'm planning on doing the western side of the United States, LA, San Diego, going through Arizona, Texas, Oklahoma, New Mexico, and then heading up towards Salt Lake and Seattle, doing that sort of area, and then back into Vegas and then LA from there. Really looking forward to doing that. If you're in those areas and you wanna have a chat and you wanna, you know, interact with us on the podcast or anything like that, even just in a short little thing, get in touch with me, guys. I've said it before, not long ago, but email through at theaslutpodcast@gmail.com. Get a hold of us at theaslutpodcast on both Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Get a hold of me. I'd love to meet you guys and talk to you guys in person as well. There is a possibility that I'll be doing a few seminars while I'm on my travels as well, so that'll be really, really cool and really, really exciting for me as well. Because that's what I got into this game for. For those of you who haven't been listening the whole time, I got into this to be able to talk to people and to educate and to do all of that sort of thing. So to be able to finally perhaps get on and do some of that will be really, really exciting and really, really fun and even challenging for me. So really, really looking forward to that. It'll be a lot of fun. Hopefully it all goes ahead. It looks like it is at this point. I've just got to wait on work to give me the leave and then to be able to save up all the money that I can to go and do the things I want to do, people. It's going to be, a whole heap of fun. I'll put the list of cities up and whatnot as I get closer to the time. and some of the dates that I'll be talking and whatnot at, which will be really, really cool, and I hope see some of you guys there as well. But enough of me babbling on, I think, at this point. Let's get into today's guest, Cat Star. Please, enjoy.
Of atmosphere, 'cause I'll doze off safe and soundly, but I'll miss your arms around me. I'd send a postcard to you, dear, 'cause I'm
cool. So welcome to the podcast, Cat Stark. How are we? How are you doing?
I'm doing really great, thanks.
Cool. I want to thank you so much. Just before we jump into everything, I want to thank you so much for being on. You're a day behind us, almost a full 24 hours.
Yeah,
it's New Year's Eve here. It's 10:20 in the morning. It's 1:20 there in the afternoon, the day before New Year's Eve. So it kind of worked together. It didn't, but hey, we're here now. So thank you very much for coming on this week.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
Cool. So there's a fair few people. I have listeners all over the place, New Zealand, Australia. The American ones may know you, may not. Tell us a wee bit about you.
Sure. As you said, my name is Kat Stark. I am a writer. I released last year a memoir about my non-monogamous experience called Yelling in Pasties, The Wet Coast Confessions of an Anxious Slut. And the audiobook of that is coming out very soon, as soon as Audible approves my files. So that's pretty exciting. I am also a blogger and a podcaster. My partner Flick and I have a podcast called On the Wet Coast. And we've been running that for a few years. And trying to think of anything else I should use to describe myself. As the title of the book suggests, I do deal with mental illness. Anxiety is a big part of my experience. Mm-hmm. And over the past couple of years, I've dealt with a certain amount of depression. And I write about that a lot because it really impacts my experiences, both with my sexuality and in all of my relationships.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. It would do too. I'm gonna read out your sort of Twitter little bio thing to help you along.
Sure.
Obviously, you noted on the author part and the book, which, fantastic title, The Wet Coast Confessions of an Anxious. I love that so much. So you're non-monogamous. So okay, I'll read it all out at once, shall I? Non-monogamous, sure. Geeky Canadian feminist queer pervert podcaster audiobook narrator.
Yes, all those things.
And you go by she and them, which is awesome. So that's a lot of descriptive words there.
Yes.
A lot of descriptive words. So did it take you a while to even just come up with that to explain yourself? Or describe yourself?
For sure. I had a really hard time actually paring it down to mm-hmm. so few words. I think at one point, before I had my book title in there, it was a whole lot longer of just like single descriptors. definitely, you know, non-monogamous. I've actually been married for 22 years, I think.
Okay.
That to my partner Flick, yet he and I about 4 years ago decided to become non-monogamous in our marriage. And that has been working really well. I'd say we'd probably call ourselves polyamorous for the most part now. I often just say open or non-monogamous because I sometimes the polyamory scene can be a bit restrictive in what they think polyamory should be.
Yeah, sure.
And so I find that I'm not always identifying with that because, as I said, I am a slut and I do like having casual sex. And I'm definitely not one of these people that it's like, no, it's all about the love. It's all about the relationships that way because, yeah, I like having sex with people and I don't have to know them especially well or love them to do that.
For sure. See that. I find that quite interesting because I consider myself polyamorous, but
I'm in the same boat where I don't need to have that emotional connection with people to go and sleep with them, go and have sexual activity, and go and do whatever I like with that. But I still, I guess it's because the scene here and the scene in Canada on the West Coast where you are is a little bit different in that way, I guess.
Yeah, and I think it depends where you are and which circles you run in. A lot of the people I've encountered through going to events, especially with the Life on the Swing Set crew, a lot of people seem to, share my sort of methodology as far as all of this goes. We sometimes swing and we sometimes go to orgies and all this kind of thing. So it just kind of depends what's going on. Yet have both had and have like really strong emotional love connections with some people, and that's awesome too. Like it's nice getting to have the variety.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be the same every single time, does it? It can be a spur of the moment thing, or it can be something that where you're dating someone for a few months, and there's no real restrictions on it. And I think that's what I love about the lifestyle in general. Like most people let you do you, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
And that makes it a lot more fun and a lot less stressful and a lot less drama, I guess. But yeah, we're going to talk about poly quite a bit as we go through this, but you're on here today because I'm in the middle of a multi-part series around online and long-distance relationships, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, you're not currently in one of those, either of those, but you have been in the past, right?
Yeah, we split up from the romantic part of our relationship sort of in the summer. Okay. But it had been about 3 years that we were involved long distance.
Oh, wow.
And have continued, a friendship, but decided that it just wasn't really working the other part of our relationship. So, and I had previously been in another long distance relationship that lasted about a year, I think.
Yep.
And there's a lot I really like about the long distance, and there's a lot that kind of works better for me in the long distance because I am so anxious and such an introvert. Mm-hmm. I find that people who have big expectations of me as far as my time and like in person hanging out can be really difficult for me. And so the long distance thing has worked out really well because we can chat like all the time, and yet we aren't seeing each other all the time. There's no expectation of a weekly date or multiple dates a week or that kind of thing, where it's definitely hard to not get to see someone very often.
Sure.
And the people that I was dating were ways away. One was Chicago, one was in San Francisco kind of area, so that those are both a long way from Vancouver, but it just seemed to work really well as far as just my personality and how my needs are.
And this is something that I've stumbled across quite a bit, because I've done a fair amount of research into all of this sort of stuff now, and I talked about it with somebody else as well while I was going through all of it. The anxiety side of it, I think, is a big part of people moving towards the online and long distance sort of relationships nowadays, because there is less pressure on you to have to go out and meet somebody at a bar or anything like that. There's less pressure to have to go and talk to somebody brand new or have a big crowd around you or so many of these things. And I believe I haven't found any correlating results and research into this, but I believe it can actually help anxious people to move to help with their anxiety and end up moving out of that, for lack of a better term.
Yeah, I think it gives you the opportunity to have successes, which helps you take the next step and take more risks.
Yeah, and I think that can only really be a good thing. If it's helping somebody with the mental side of who they are and that side, then why not let people do it, right?
For sure. And, you know, it can, like, it maybe won't help someone be, like, more social in wanting to go to a munch or, like, a meetup kind of thing. But if they're having relationships and feeling connected and, like, getting their needs met, like, yeah, like, who would complain about that?
Exactly. But there's always got to be the detractors of it all, isn't there? The people that will sit there and go, why don't you just get out and meet somebody and, you know, have that physical side of things and all of that sort of stuff. And you just sort of look at those people. Well, I look at those people and go, how about just let people be them? Not sit there and try and pull them back. Because by pulling them back and saying, why don't you just go out and meet somebody or whatever it might be, you're actually making it more difficult for them to go and do that, I feel.
Yeah, and it's always people who are extroverted and really comfortable in social situations that say this kind of thing. You know, it's like, oh, it's not hard, just go talk to someone. Well, yeah, that's great for you to say, because that's the way your brain works. And it's not that I don't, you know, go on dates and do that kind of thing, but we're going to meet online first, you know, through some sort of dating app. We're going to, like, establish a connection that way and then go meet in person. Because if I can't talk to you comfortably online, if we haven't got any sort of flow going, then, you know, it's probably not going to work.
Yeah, but by the same token of that, though, and again, looking into the research in this, once you meet, that level of communication might not be there even then still. So it could happen online and it's nice and natural online, and then you meet up and it just doesn't fit well. And like I said, going through the research on this, I think part of that is because when you're talking online to someone, even like we are now, we're not able to see each other or anything like that. We're only receiving about 7% of the communication that's been given by the other person.
Yeah, that's very true.
And the other 93% is the body language, the face, the responses, how the face is reacting to everything, and all that sort of stuff. That's 93%. And the other 7% is either just, I think it's probably a bit more than 7% for what we're doing, because we've got talk and we've got tone there. But if it's just text, then you're actually receiving very little communication from the person, so that when you get to that point where you're finally meeting, it can all still be a little bit awkward.
Yeah, that's fair, because you don't necessarily know someone from that kind of communication. You get a good sense of them, but, you know, how often do you not actually know someone you've met, like, 25 times? But yeah, I totally agree, because there is a decent amount of guesswork that is going on based on, you know, just having text-based conversations, because you are missing all those other pieces. So there is a lot of, like, clarification and asking for clarity, because it's like, well, what exactly did you mean by that? And there definitely has been issues that came up in my relationships, because we were saying the same thing but didn't necessarily mean it, or, like, from the same place. And that can be very confusing.
Absolutely can. And it can sort of throw things out of whack when you've gotten yourself into that zone where you're finally meeting this person, everything's going to be awesome, and you've created this sort of idealistic picture of how it's going to be, and then it doesn't happen. You can end up quite dejected from it, I feel, as well.
Mm-hmm, for sure. And I did have an experience. You know, he was a local guy. We met online, and we were chatting a bit, and we just got on like a house on fire when we were chatting. We were just, like, it's quick and witty, and the banter, it was phenomenal. And then we met, and it was like, huh, like, it was just kind of awkward, and we just didn't really have any chemistry. And, like, I really tried to make it work, because I thought, no, we've got this great connection. But it turned out that we only had a connection at a distance. And after getting together a couple times, it's just like, there's just nothing here.
So I want to go back to the fact you were in a relationship, in an online relationship, long distance, for 3 years, you said, right, recently. So through that, how did it evolve? How did it start, first of all, and then how did it evolve from there?
Well, we met on Twitter, of all the places.
As you do.
And Yeah, as you do. And we just started chatting and yeah, just kind of hit it off, and it was a little bit flirty, and it was really shortly after my partner Flick and I became non-monogamous. And so I just thought I would practice flirting because it wasn't something I had done in a long time. And I thought, well, here's, you know, this internet rando, like, you know, he's kind of charming. Like, why don't I flirt with him? And it, like, we just really hit it off, and it just built from there. We just found ourselves talking more and more, and decided to go to there's an event that Life on the Swing Set holds in at a resort in Mexico in November, the Desire Resort Spa thing. Yeah, and so we decided that we were going to go to that, and this was 3 years ago or whatever, and this was an opportunity to meet this guy, but it was about like 9 months out from our first meet, or our like online meet. And so yeah, just as the year went on and we chatted more, we ended up deciding to go to Chicago in the summer of that year to meet up with him and his partner, because we sort of thought, you know, before we buy plane tickets to Mexico, maybe we should find out if this chemistry works. Because we figured we would meet some other cool people, and the more I'd heard about the event, they all just sounded super geeky and really into a lot of the similar pop culture things that we were, and there's a certain amount of kink going on, and it all sounded so intriguing. But we thought, like, I just need to know that there is something with this guy. So we met up with them, and it was just on. So we just went from there, and there was a lot of it that worked really well for both of us, just because we actually were similar, and that was part of one of the things we bonded on, is being similarly anxious people. And we just really understood how each other's brains worked, and we were able to support one another and really help meet the other's needs in a way, because we got it.
And that's kind of wonderful, that. I do find it interesting that you decided to meet up at something that is, it's not actually a swingers resort, but it's mainly used for that, isn't it?
Yeah, very much so. And the approach of all of that is very much the swinging kind of thing. And we tried a fair bit of swinging when we were first open, because we were like, I don't know, let's have a threesome. Sure, this is super fun. I don't know, maybe we're swingers. Let's try swinging. And so we did that a few times, and just like we had a great time, but just found that sort of connection wasn't necessarily like that, trying to meet like another couple and just have all of us like mesh in the right way is a really tricky dynamic. And but definitely at the Desire Resort, there was a lot of that sort of quick, like meeting these people, but you would, you know, spend 6 hours talking in the hot tub, like several nights in a row. And so, you know, you felt you actually knew these people pretty well, and you just spent so much of the day together that, you know, it's often like months of dating time crammed into a week.
Absolutely, it is, but it's so. I've always wanted to go, and this is a problem with me living in New Zealand, is that Mexico is so far away.
Because it's real far from Vancouver. Yeah, and
it's a 16-hour flight or something, I think, to LA, and then to get down from there.
Yeah, it's a long, long trip for you.
Yeah. I was in New York last year, just over a year ago now, and I remember my flight then, and it's an absolute killer at the best of times.
Yeah, I've done that trip from here to Australia, and yeah, that's a hell of a trip.
And my flight back, I had two, larger people on either side of me, and I'm quite large myself. It was just uncomfortable. It was just quite uncomfortable. I was sweating and they were sweating, and it just ended up all slimy. And at that point, I decided I'm never flying economy again. Not a chance.
It's not fun.
So, just getting back to the relationship you were with the threes, what were some of the issues that you found while you were going through this relationship? What were some of the barriers, I guess?
Yeah, I think some of the barriers were definitely like only being able to see each other a few times a year. And so there was a lot of pressure in each of those times we managed to get together. Mm-hmm. So if I'd flown down to Chicago for a long weekend or something, we only had 4 days and we haven't seen each other for like 4 months or something. So it's like, okay, this has to be like real quality time. And we have to get like as much connection and as much physical time and as much like all these things. There was just so much pressure on being on in those moments. And sometimes you just had a real shit week, or you had a bug, or you're depressed, or like just all sorts of things going on, or you're having difficulty in one of your own other relationships. But you had to just try to be in that moment, just because that was the only time you had. And so that was definitely, it put a lot of pressure on every time we did manage to get together.
Yeah. I can imagine what, because there seems to be that expectation there that you need to go and do something, right? That you need to spend as much time, you need to do all the fun, sexy things, you need to do, go out and have your dates and all of that sort of stuff, which is exhausting, let's be honest. It's not always easy.
No, for sure. And we, like, neither of us, have a crap ton of money. And I think this kind of thing is a lot easier if you've got a lot of disposable income that you can, whip back and forth every month or something like that, as opposed to, these are trips you're really having to scramble to make happen. Mm-hmm. And so you realize like what you're sacrificing to get there as well. And so it just keeps adding the pressure more and more and more. So yeah, that was definitely quite challenging to be able to, A, get time together, and B, have that time together be like satisfying. And also like, you would end up leaving kind of exhausted and just sort of wrung out from the intensity of it.
Yeah, sure. But with being non-monogamous and having a partner that you're in a geographically close relationship, does that help out a little bit as part of that, do you think? Or does that make it more difficult?
Yeah, I think it definitely helps, because I really feel like I get my needs met as far as the intimate, cuddly,
just
really
the physical side of it.
Yeah, the physical side and that real emotional, comfortable closeness.
Yeah.
Like that is quite effortless with Flick. And so yeah, being able to just come home to ease, or to just know that I've got that part of my needs met, really helped me to not feel like, okay, this other relationship has to fulfill like all of these needs for me.
Yeah. And that's why I feel it would be quite difficult for me personally, as somebody who's also non-monogamous, to just have a single relationship in that long distance sort of realm. That is just me personally. I have had long distance relationships before, and they've been absolutely fantastic, but I was always monogamous with those. Looking at it now, I'm sitting there going, could I actually just do it and having a single relationship that is long distance or online or however you want to put it?
Yeah, I think that would be much harder. I can't see doing that. Like I really like a lot of time on my own, mm-hmm. but I think that having an only long distance relationship without being able to get those other needs met. And I think you can get a certain amount of that met with like with close friends and that kind of thing. And sometimes you even can have like cuddly friendships if that's, works for everyone and stuff. So you can get a certain amount of that. But
absolutely. But
yeah, like it not being able to just sort of almost whenever I want, just like hold him tight and just be like, okay, this is great.
Because I mean, let's face it. The one of the main detractors of online relationships from people who are conservative or people who aren't in them is, where do you get that physical side from? That when you need to be hugged, you get hugged. When you need to get laid, you get laid, et cetera, et cetera. And and it is one of the biggest sort of, I don't want to say downfalls, but challenges is probably the way that I would put it, is if you're in that, not even monogamous, it's just a single relationship that is online, that, how do you think that people get over that, for lack of a better term? Can people get over that?
Yeah, I think it's tricky, and I think every person in every relationship has to figure that out for themselves. I think there's a certain amount of that you can do, you know, with masturbation and with, like, if you do Skype calling or that kind of thing, like the video chat type thing, FaceTime, whatever. And that was something we did not do in my long distance relationship. I did it with the person in San Francisco, but that wasn't a component of the relationship with the person in Chicago. So, like, we didn't even really have that face to face, like, voice kind of thing. Uh-huh. And as you know, two anxious people, the phone is kind of our worst enemy.
Yeah,
so
yeah, sure.
It just wasn't really something that we felt very comfortable doing, but there were definitely times that was hard, and we had a couple of crisis times where we did end up, like, talking voice to voice, because we just needed that in those moments. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it can definitely be pretty tricky. But I mean, I also think of a lot of people in, like, monogamous relationships who aren't necessarily doing a lot of that physical closeness or sexual closeness with the person that they live with.
Yeah.
So I think that is even harder if you've got the person, like, with you.
Yeah,
and you
sure.
don't necessarily have that kind of connection. I think with a long distance situation, there's a lot more comfort with the idea of, like, self-pleasure and that kind of thing, that sometimes people in monogamous relationships like are super uncomfortable with, like, how dare you masturbate? I'm supposed to be the one that fulfills that for you.
Yeah, sure.
And so I think there's much more versatility in that, even if that long distance relationship was the only relationship you were in.
Mm. I do think it helps with the emergence of, you know, demisexuality and asexuality now. I think that online relationships could, even monogamous ones, could quite suit the people that identify as that as well, because that physical part isn't a necessary thing. It's all about the connection mm-hmm. and the emotion with those people. So I think that's a really great thing to look at as well.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, like I said, the detractors are there for the whole physicality side of it, but if you don't need that, then the emotional side is the biggest part for you, then it's kind of ideal.
Yeah.
Which is kind of interesting. I think it's interesting that those sorts of sexualities have only come up in recent times as well. Considering they've always been around, there's always been people like that, but it's become part of the conversation, and how we react to those sorts of people now is a lot different to what it used to be.
For sure. And it's something I definitely have to be aware of, because I'm sort of so, like, I think Dr. Liz and the Frisky Fairy coined the term, like, megasexual, where the opposite of demisexual, where you, like, I need to know that there can be a sexual connection before I can really form much of an intimate relationship in person.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the other thing, that's it's easier online, because there's less, like, I don't feel like my person is being invaded in a way that
sure.
I do with people that I meet in person. And I found with Flick's partner, who lives here in town, we had been in a triad for a while, but she and I ended up deciding that wasn't working for us over time. So, you know, we've just become, like, we just have this great, loving, connected friendship. But I found that she would, like, look at me, and I always felt like she was, like, staring into my soul. And I would just be like, stop that. And so, like, I can feel really invaded by people when I meet them in person, and as people try to get to know me and sort of want pieces of me to be shared with them, like I can feel really threatened and uncomfortable with that. Whereas online, when there's the distance, when there's not someone like looking into my eyes and stuff, mm-hmm. I'm able to let down those barriers in a way.
Yeah, so that you've got a little bit of a safety net there, right?
Yeah, yeah. And so when we do meet in person, I've often let some of those barriers down in advance, and then I can actually let them get to know me in a way that I can't if our getting to know time is really spent a lot in person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And so with you were in your GCR and your LDR, sorry, geographically close and long distance relationships at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
She
and I ended up deciding because when we talked about it, she was like, I think the long distance relationships actually work for you better. That like, I think that they work not despite the distance, but because of the distance. Mm-hmm. And so one of the manifestations of a relationship that we tried when we were like attempting to stay kind of connected, physically, sexually, that sort of way, that we sort of decided we'd kind of have a long distance relationship, but she just lives in a suburb away.
Right. So most of the contact was online and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Not seeing each other
and
face to face so much.
The weekly dates that had been part of our triad dynamic and all that stuff that just freaked the shit out of me and just had me feeling so stressed and boxed in and like just panicky. We were able to let that go and just have a, oh, hey, you know, you're in town this weekend, let's get together kind of approach to it, as opposed to that kind of pressure. And it did help. We weren't right for each other, but it definitely did help in that way.
Hmm. Yeah, that's kind of cool that you were able to try and work through that. Obviously, it didn't come out through the other end, but it was trying basically an alternative way for it to work instead of just going, no, this isn't going to work, which is kind of lovely in this day and age where I feel a lot of people just go, no, not working, see ya.
Yeah, and it's tough when you're doing a triad with the person that you're living with and spent your entire adult life with, that, you know, you are going to try a lot harder to try to get all of this to work. Because, you know, I cared about her so much, but I also cared about him so much, and I really wanted to make it work. And I blamed myself a lot for why it wasn't working, just like, I'm broken, I'm an ice queen, I'm this and that, like, as opposed to just being like, okay, this is just how I function. And it took me a long time to get to a place where I could be comfortable with the fact that this is how I work, and that that's okay. And that she worked a different way, and that was okay, but we just couldn't work together that way. And so the woman that I'm dating now, who lives in the city, we're quite close and have a real ease in our relationship, but there's very few expectations of time. And she works shift work, so it means that she's not available a huge amount. And so when she is, like, we sort of have to schedule way in advance and that kind of thing. But it means, like, it is quite intermittent, but we can chat whenever we want and send each other sexy pictures and stuff. But it's just it's just so low pressure that it just it feels really comfortable and wonderful.
And it sort of sounds like it's a mix of both. So you're close to each other, but you're still able to sort of keep it in that kind of comfortable long distance style of relationship.
Yeah, and that just seems to work better for me.
Yeah, and that's what life's about, and especially love, is finding what works for you and then going for it from that point, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because you spend enough of your teens and your younger years throwing as much crap at the wall and seeing what sticks. Eventually, you've got to find out what does it for you, though.
For sure. And I think that's the other thing about doing this, like becoming open in our 40s, is that we, you know, we got together when we were like 20 years old, mm-hmm. and I hadn't had a huge amount of dating experience. I'd had a couple long-term boyfriends before I met him,
yeah.
and he'd had a bit more of an adventurous life than I had, but like I really didn't know all that much about myself and how I worked mm-hmm. until we started doing this. And so these weren't lessons I learned in those younger dating years. Like, this was all stuff I had to learn like in my 40s. And it's, yeah, it can really sort of shatter your sense of yourself to a certain extent to be trying to figure this shit out when you're at my age.
I actually thought you were a lot younger, so that's I'm turning 30 next year, and I'm absolutely terrified of it.
I found 29 harder than 30, I have to admit.
No, 29.
But I'm turning 46 next year, and that, oh, I'm having some feels about that one.
Yeah,
45 was kind of scary, but 46, like, but yeah. I'm living my best life. I'm having an awesome time. And so, yeah, I really can't complain.
And yeah, that's really all that matters. I do want to ask though, you became non-monogamous, you said about 4 years ago, right?
Yeah.
How did that come? I always love this question because everybody has a different answer. How did that come about? How did that conversation go? How did it get brought up? How did that happen?
Yeah, it's interesting because like really early in our marriage, we'd had a little bit of flexibility because, as I said, we got together when we were really young, and I was bisexual but had never had an opportunity to have any experience with women. And so we had some flexibility, and I was able to go and have some experiences with some women so that I could like know that that was a piece of me and have that fulfilled. And that was great. And then I did it a few times. I'm like, ah, cool.
And great. Then we just,
yeah. But it wasn't something I felt like I needed as such, right. But it was just good to sort of anchor that piece of me and be like, yeah, that is legitimately how I feel. This was super sexy and wonderful, but you know, this is the life we're building, and that's great. So yeah, you know, there had been a little bit of that flex in it. And then probably about 6 months before we decided to open up, we just were really connecting in ways, and we were having way more sex than we'd had in ages. I was writing a lot of dirty slash fiction, mm-hmm. and I think I was just like ramped up all the time and just feeling super sexy, and just like writing about men's bodies was making me crave his body. And so we just had gotten into this really great groove, mm-hmm. and started thinking about what kind of adventures we could maybe have.
Right.
And we ended up going to see Dan Savage, the Seattle-based, yeah. And he was live doing a podcast here in town, and so we went to see him.
Awesome.
And hearing him say, like, that everyone wants to fuck other people just really clicked for me. And of course, as we were talking about asexuals and demisexuals, like, not necessarily everyone wants to fuck other people, but the majority of people want to fuck other people.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that really helped me to see that A, wanting to fuck other people wasn't a flaw that I had, and B, him wanting to fuck other people didn't mean that I was worthless.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that had been a big piece for me, is just the insecurity, and would have thought, well, you know, it's like I'm garbage and therefore he wants other people. Mm-hmm. And so that really flipped a switch for me. So we started talking about having adventures and maybe having a threesome and all that kind of thing. And yeah, it just kind of spiraled from there. But it was pretty comfortable, probably it was me that really brought it up more about like, maybe we should actually do this. Mm-hmm. But it really felt like it kind of happened pretty organically, that we were both just moving toward it. And we thought we'd maybe just go to like a sex club and like have sex in public, and even that was like, whoo. And then it just kind of, yeah, it just kind of went from there. We talked to a friend of ours who's bisexual, and just put it out there. We're like, hey, like, absolutely no pressure, and if it's a no, like, no problem at all. But we think you're really cute and wanted to know if you wanted to have a threesome with us. And she was like, yeah, that sounds fun. And so, yeah,
it's easy for everyone.
I know. And we had this ridiculous time of having a few bisexual female friends who were just into it. And we know that that's not everyone's experience. And, and so, yeah, we were incredibly fortunate in that way to be able to have that step into it, and with a good friend who was close enough that we thought, like, if this really goes sideways, we won't be like destroying our like friendship circle, you know. But you know, close enough that we just felt like comfortable, and she was happy because she was not interested in relationships and all the just day-to-day bullshit of dealing with people and their needs.
Yeah.
But liked that there were some people out there who wanted to have sex with her every now and then, and she could just do that with absolutely no strings attached, and it was ideal for her as well.
Sounds pretty ideal in general, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah. No, we were just, yeah, so ridiculously fortunate.
Yeah. Oh. I'm just thinking about that now and just going, why does this stuff not happen to me? But in saying that, I'm sleeping with somebody now that I'm not with, so that doesn't really count. But that's a new thing, so I'm excited about that, and it's great and it's fun.
Mm-hmm.
You've got that NRE without the relationship part of it. It's just a new play thing, and that's it was something that took ages to actually happen, which is kind of funny, and then it finally did, and we've been like, yeah, this is sweet. This is great, because technically I'm single but non-monogamous, and it's a strange thing for me to be going through that as well.
Mm-hmm.
But I go off topic. I do that a lot. People who listen to me ramble on, I go off topic so many times that it's not funny, and I end up talking about something completely different, and then I've got to get out the fishing rod and reel myself back in and go again.
I think every conversation is just like tangents strung together, really.
I think you're absolutely right. I just seem to be somewhat adept at just slinging webs in between everything. I'm kind of like Spider-Man of conversation. That's the way that I'll put it. So it seemed like everything was really quite natural with you moving into the non-monogamy side of it, which is so cool, because I mean, having a partner that's up for it is one thing, but then actually navigating all of the feelings and stuff around that is a whole separate sort of thing, which I think that's the most difficult part.
For sure.
Especially when it comes to, and I don't like using this as a feeling, but jealousy. I don't believe jealousy is a feeling personally. I think it's a amalgamation of a whole bunch of different feelings, and you've got to melt it down to find out which one you're actually feeling. But having to know yourself and knowing how to deal with the emotions that are coming through in a positive way, I think, is one of the really difficult things. Did you find that challenging at all, or was that sort of natural in the process as well?
Yeah, it was an interesting mix of the two, because okay. I think, again, you know, coming into it with a relationship that was so long term, we just really had a solid foundation. Mm-hmm. And so we knew that if things went wrong, we really had already been through like 2 decades of, you know, all kinds of shit. So it really, you know, it just wasn't going to rock us in the way that it might with a newer relationship.
Yeah,
and sure. So just having that really stable base freed us to be, you know, more exploratory and step into things. It also meant that we like stepped on a lot of rakes that hit us in the face. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we were able to recover from that and support each other through that. Mm-hmm. And I think you know, definitely we've always looked at jealous feelings as being a signpost of, you know, a need that's not being met, basically, yeah. or several needs not being met. It's like, okay, I'm having these feelings, like what is it telling me?
Yeah, exactly.
And so what I found, like, the sexual part of it, I was just like all over it, like just compersion out the wahoo. Like, it just, I loved the idea of him with other people. I loved seeing him with other people. I loved, like, setting up our sort of downstairs suite for his dates, like all of that kind of thing. Like, I loved that zing. And it wasn't until I sort of saw some of the more emotional connections and some of that intimacy that was building, mm-hmm. that those are the moments that really nailed me with the jealous feels, and with, like, figuring out, like, oh, like, what does this mean for me, and why am I feeling so threatened, and that kind of thing, in those moments. And it took, you know, it took a lot of thinking and a lot of talking about it. And, you know, we had the freedom to talk about stuff in a way that sometimes, yeah, people aren't always comfortable hearing. And, mm-hmm. and just knowing that, you know, it didn't mean he was doing anything wrong, and it didn't mean anything even had to change. It was just like, this is what I feel, mm-hmm. Helped us move through a lot of that in a more comfortable way. And the same with when, you know, he was having that kind of thing about what I was experiencing. Like, we felt free to express it.
Yeah.
And the other person didn't feel attacked or defensive or any of that. Like, we were able to just be, like, quite objective about it. Mm-hmm. And I think both he and I have, like, quite a lot of that sort of emotional intelligence thing where we can be very objective about our feelings, even when we're in the midst of feeling the shit out of them. Yeah. We can kind of step back and be like, huh, what does this mean?
Yeah.
So it allowed us to work through a lot of that.
And an important part of that that I want to touch on just quickly is the fact that you had a solid base there. And I think that's hugely important. I think a lot of people who maybe have just come into opening up their relationship and things like that, they believe that another person is going to help them fix the relationship that they're in.
Oh, yeah.
And I believe that that's incredibly dangerous. It's more than likely going to make it worse. You need to try and have that solid base within your current relationship before bringing somebody else into it and potentially ruining both, I guess.
For sure. Absolutely. Like, because, you know, this shit is hard. Like, this is relationships on hard mode. And I mean, monogamy is hard. So it's not like monogamous is easy, and having a long-term marriage is not an easy thing by any means. But yeah, this stuff is really difficult. And if you're not in a place where you can be in it, like, working together in a team of whether, like, however many people are in that team, it's not gonna work.
Nope. But I think, yeah, that a lot of people have that misconception around it, though. And mm-hmm. hopefully people are going through to Munches or whatever. We have a poly meetup here every 3 months, and I'm hoping more and more people who get into this sort of lifestyle are understanding that.
Mm-hmm.
I really, really hope they are. Otherwise, it can get messy and you end up cleaning it up for them. And it's, mm-hmm. and that's not a fun thing to do either. We're almost getting to the end of our hour. That's gone by really quite quickly, which is awesome. So I've got a couple of final questions.
Sure.
Just for us to finish off. When you're in a long distance relationship, we'll go on full circle and go back into the relationship side of it instead of just poly. What works for you and what doesn't? This is going to be basically a summation of what we've talked about, really. But in that relationship, what works and what doesn't?
Well, what really works for me is, you know, the text-based communication. I really like that. And I like being able to check in all the time and, you know, send each other messages during the workday. And I found that I could really feel very connected to someone through regular communication in that way. That can also fall into the what doesn't work thing is if, you know, your partner is going through a depressive episode and isn't feeling like chatting. That means that, you know, that the only touchstones you have are gone and you're kind of flailing without being able to like get together physically and see how each other's doing or like, you know, pet their head in your lap while they just are, you know, in a depressive episode and they can't talk, like you can have that connection when you're apart from each other. That's just not an option. So that is really difficult. And the pressure on those times where you do get together, just that, like, okay, this has to work and it has to be amazing. And everyone has to just be feeling great and ready to go and just be like on their sexiest behavior, you know, when we don't necessarily feel it. You know, I had a bad bout of vertigo when my partner from Chicago was here. And I'm like, I'm doing all this shit anyway, even though I was like constantly having to like hold on to the bed because I thought I was going to fall off the earth. But like we had a day. And so that's what we had. And so I had to just like, there's a lot of just sucking it up and going with it.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah, it puts a lot of pressure on those times you do get together. But yeah, I think those for me are the biggest parts. The other thing is I'm very tactile. I'm very physical. And so not being able to like touch that person, you know, is tricky for me. And so when we do get together, I just kind of want to spider monkey around them the entire time. Because it's just like, I'm so starved for your touch, but thankfully I can get, you know, a lot of my touch needs met, through my other relationships, but you know, I want to touch you, yeah. Which can be really hard.
For sure. And one final one, it's a similar sort of question, but it has a wee bit of differences, and we've talked about the physicality side of it quite a bit just now, but the differences between your long distance relationship and your geographic close relationships, what are some of the differences that you've found and have you worked through them? Because obviously you've been with one partner for 20 plus years and these new ones are coming through, and it's obviously not going to be the same sort of way that you work through everything. So what are some of the differences that you've found or some of the similarities?
Yeah, I've found that I feel so secure with my long-term partner Flick that I'm much more likely to express needs that aren't being met and, you know, fight and do those sorts of things. Whereas in my long distance and the newer relationships, I'm much more likely to just kind of try to make everything work.
Yeah.
Even when I'm not happy. And so I switch into a bit of a pleaser mode because I just, you know, we get so little together that like I want all of that time that we are chatting or if we're in the physical space or whatever, like I want that to be good.
Yeah, sure.
And so I can just squash a lot of my needs in a pretty unhealthy way in those relationships. And that was definitely part of why one of them ended up, you know, crumbling was because I wasn't getting my needs met and I wasn't really expressing that. And it was sort of building into a bit of a crisis.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that's definitely a lot more difficult with me in those relationships. And so I don't find that I'm confident enough to do those real self-care things of expressing myself in a way. And I'm hoping that I'm learning from this and will get better at it from having fucked it up. Like I'm like failing ever upward kind of thing. But yeah, that's definitely the thing that came up the most is just just not having that really stable foundation, there feels like way more risk in saying like, hey, that's not cool. Because I feel like the other person's going to be like, all right, see ya.
Yeah. And I guess people don't put too much stock in a relationship that's only been going, not even going, but that's sort of been around for only a couple of weeks. So that makes, that makes a lot more sense as opposed to the multi-year relationship that you have on the other side.
Yeah.
I do have one more question.
Sure.
So for people that are navigating through what is now a really quite a digital world where you've got dating apps, you've got most people going through those dating apps and dating websites and things to meet people, what's some advice that you'd give somebody who's just coming into this realm?
Oh, wow. That's a biggie.
Because my big one is obviously the safety side, which we haven't really talked about
too
much. People aren't always who they say they are online.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's very true, and that's why, you know, I didn't, like, fly off to Chicago on my own to meet him in a hotel room kind of thing. Like, there was a very different kind of situation, but yeah, I think overall people talk about safety in this sort of thing, like, more than anything else. Mm-hmm. So, like, obviously you want to be sensible about the safety concerns. But I think really expressing your needs is the really important thing to do. Like, be clear about what kind of communication you want to have, like how often you want to talk. Do you want like good morning, good night every night? Or like, do you want those every day? Or is it just a like start a conversation at midday, kind of like where you left off the previous day kind of thing? Like, what are your needs? What are your expectations? Because I think we often just think that people are going to work the way we do. And that's just not the case.
No.
And unless you tell people what you need, they can't give it to you. Or they can't say that, no, they like are incapable of giving that to you, and perhaps you should maybe move on to other people. And the earlier you can do that sort of thing before you're so emotionally invested in something that is going to eventually crash and burn, the better.
Absolutely. And
Oh, I was just saying, and like, know what it means to you when you're in NRE, like understand how you function in that new relationship energy, like infatuated, like chemical soup, wee kind of thing. Like, know how you are in that kind of situation so that you can make the best decisions you can.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more with that. And that's knowing a lot about yourself as well, which a lot of people don't want to do. But it is hugely important if you want it to succeed or go anywhere, I think. Otherwise, it's just you're in for what can be a decent amount of effort and, for lack of a better term, trouble as well if you don't do that sort of grunt work before you move into something.
Yeah.
But that's just me. So, yeah, cool. No, that was awesome. Thank you so much for coming on and talking with me. It's been super interesting, and it's great to talk to somebody else with a different point of view as well. Because like I said, I've had my own online and long distance relationships, and it's been sort of some of them I'd never met, which, you know, it happens sometimes, right? It's just one of those things. But you've also got the type where you start together and then move apart. I've had those as well. But I think it's really interesting having that sort of distance there and having, for lack of a better term, your nesting partner there as well. I think that was really, really cool to hear about and to talk about. So thank you so much.
Oh, I really appreciate it. Thanks for inviting me on.
No worries at all. I'll have to have you back on at some point.
Sure.
Just before we go, where can people find you? Where can they find the podcast? Where can they find the book? All that sort of stuff. Plug yourself.
Okay. My book, Yelling in Pasties, The Wet Coast Confessions of an Anxious Slut, it's available on Amazon or any of the places that you get ebooks. You can get the paperback from Amazon, but you can get the ebook in sort of any different format that you want from the places you get that kind of thing. The audiobook version should be available very soon on Audible. And I'm super excited about that. That was a fuck ton of work, and I never want to edit any audio again. But the other place is onthewetcoast.com is our website. That's where my blog is, toy reviews. Our podcasts are also there. And the podcast On the Wet Coast is available through any of the typical podcast places. If you're searching on like Apple Podcasts or anything, put Wet Coast as one word, just because random annoying computery things. And I'm on Twitter at Wet Coast Cat, and that's Cat with K. And I I tweet a lot. So if you enjoy a lot of that kind of shenanigans, I'm on there. And I think that's the main bit of all that.
Awesome. So yeah, guys, those who are listening, do go and check those out. Do get onto the book. I'll be getting onto the book as soon as it comes out on the audio. Really, really looking forward to it. And it's been a really, really fun chat. So again, I'm going to keep thanking you and keep thanking you, and it'll just end up on this giant loop and we'll be here for another 2 hours. But
oh no, you get like with the Canadian and I'll be like, oh, thank you. But then you'll be like, no, but thank you. And then we'll start apologizing and it's all going to go to hell.
Yeah, it's all about that, isn't it?
Yeah.
No, but seriously, it's been great. So, one last time, thank you very much.
Thank you.
For the touch of your lips, dear, but much more for the touch of your whips, dear. You can raise welts like nobody else as we dance to the masochism tango. Say our love is a flame, not an ember. Say it's me that you want to dismember. Blacken my eye, set fire to my tie as we dance to the masochism tango. At your command, before you here I stand, my heart is in my hand. Yeah. It's here that I must be. My heart entreats, just hear those savage beats, and go put on your cleats, and come and trample me. Your heart is hard as stone or mahogany, that's why I'm in such exquisite agony. My soul is on fire, it's aflame with desire, which is why I perspire when we tango. You caught my nose in your left castanet, love. I can feel the pain yet, love, every time I hear drums. And I envy the rose that you held in your teeth, love, with the thorns underneath, love, sticking into your gums. Your eyes cast a spell that bewitches. The last time I needed 20 stitches to sew up the gash you made with your lash as we dance to the masochism tango. Bash in my brain and make me scream with pain, then kick me once again and say we'll never part. I know too well I'm underneath your spell, so darling, if you smell something burning, it's my heart. Won't you take your cigarette from its holder and burn your initials in my shoulder, fracture my spine and swear that you're mine as we dance to the masochism tango.